acquire nuclear weapons. And then I'll close with the consequences, where we are today, focusing mostly on the period since May 1998 is the break point in India-Pakistan nuclear quake. That's when India, led by the then BJP government, tested nuclear weapons, followed 3 weeks later by the Pakistan. And close with them. So basic deterrence, right? So the definition of deterrence, very simple. This is a definition. It was all inspired by guys like Tom Schelling, Herman Kahn, Albert Wolfson. Anybody familiar with Cold War nuclear strategy? Right? So basic deterrence theory, in any context, is trying to preserve the status quo by threatening unacceptable cost to an opponent or an adversary if they do harm, right? Some specified action. So if you do X, I will do Y. And the idea is to preserve the status quo, and the idea is that Y, the punishment that you impose on your adversary opponent, should be greater than the benefit of them achieving whatever their objective is next, such that they are deterred from undertaking it. Tom Schelling used to love examples with children. So I have an 18-month-old son myself, and he's starting to understand things. And, you know, one, as children get older, right, deterrence by punishment, example that Tom Schelling used was if your child does, you know, something bad, you punish them by sending them to their room, denying them their timeout, right? So there's some punishment after the fact if they do X. In another example is if you hit me, I will kill your mother, right? So there's a punitive aspect to deterrent threat, such that the punishment exceeds the benefit of whatever an adversary is expecting. So in the Cold War, the deterrent by denial threat was counterproductive. We were going to disarm and target their own forces to make it impossible for them to carry out their first threat. So in a case where somebody is attacking me, a deterrent by denial threat would be, instead of killing your mother, I cut your arm off. You can't attack me. Right. And presumably the cost of cutting your arm off so you cannot achieve your objective in the first place is sufficient to deter you from undertaking. Right. So a good way to think about this deterrence by punishment is we will punish you with such severe cost after you undertake the action, such that you'll have no incentive, rational incentive to do so. Versus we will ratchet up the cost while you try to achieve the objective, such that you won't be able to. So I think it's an important distinction when we think about nuclear strategy. Even in the South Asian case, in the Cold War, the distinction was counterforce versus countervalue. Right? So in the Cold War nuclear strategy, when we threaten to target Soviet cities or their economic or industrial capacity, that was largely a deterrent by punishment. Right? In the event that they launched a conventional or a first nuclear strike against us, we would retaliate against the city. The alternative was, and this was a big debate early in the Cold War, in a case of a conventional conflict, we would launch nuclear weapons at their nuclear weapons, such that they would not have the ability to launch those weapons in the United States or in So the deterrent theory has several basic requirements. We call them the 3 C's. Right, so you need to have the capability to pose the threat that you're promising. Right, so if you're threatening to destroy an adversary's cities in the event they do something, you need to have the capability to do that. Right, so you need some explosive capability, but you also, most importantly, in the nuclear sense, you need a delivery capability. You need to be able to hit their city. Right, and it needs to be transparent to the adversary. It needs to be credible, right? This term credibility and the concept of credibility is what dogs Cold War strategy and still dogs nuclear strategy today, right? Credibility is the hardest part of it. How could you threaten what was tantamount, you know, mutual suicide and have to be credible by your adversary, right? So in the event of, you know, So in the Cold War, a good example is if the Soviet Union took West Berlin, was it really credible that the United States would threaten to launch hundreds of nuclear weapons in Soviet states? The Soviet Union probably didn't think so. Right? So in a deterrence by punishment versus deterrence by denial trade-off, which one do you think is more credible? Right? So in the case where an attacker is coming at you, more credible threat to kill their mother in response or to cut off their arm? What is an attacker more likely to believe? It is disproportionate to threaten certain punitive actions. And so it is often more credible, and this is where the trade-off is. The debate earlier in the Cold War about deterrence by punishment versus deterrence by denial turned on the credibility difference between the two. The deterrence by denial seemed to be more credible. The adversary is more likely to believe that you would try to stop them from achieving their objective than to kill billions of innocent civilians that had nothing to do with the fight in the first place, after something had already happened. And so the United States ended up threatening both. Right? So and part of it was that the size of the U.S. army made it possible to threaten them. But there were many strategists who believed that the deterrence by denial missions were still more credible to the adversary. But at the heart of deterrence is the issue of credibility. And the third thing is communication. The adversary needs to know that you have the capability and the credibility to threaten the punishment or deterrence by denial threat that you make. Right? You have to make a threat. It has to be public. The adversary has to know what the threat is. The adversary needs to know what objective you are laying a red line down for, and that you have the capability to put the punishment that you threat. So there's a huge amount of transparency that is required for the deterrence to operate. Right? And has anyone seen Dr. Strangelove, the movie? Right? What's the problem with the doomsday machine and Dr. Strangelove? There's a great line. What's the point of a doomsday machine if you don't tell anybody about it? Right? For everybody, the adversary needs to know that undertaking certain actions will result in some punishment or deterrence to operate. So nuclear weapons deterrence as a concept predated nuclear weapons. Right? The concept of ratcheting up the cost to try and deter an adversary predates nuclear weapons by centuries. The dawn of warfare. But nuclear weapons fundamentally alter deterrence equations for several reasons, right? One, the explosive yield, even at Hiroshima, 20 kilotons. You could kill 100,000. You could kill cities, entire cities, with, a single warhead. But more than that, the missile age really changed how deterrence could operate. Because prior to nuclear weapons, what was the most destructive military technology? Before nuclear weapons, World War II, how did the United States allies and Germany attack? Strategic bombing and firebombing, right? And the problem was that you had to send hundreds of airplanes and sorties into enemy territory to inflict that kind of damage, but your own pilots and air force is at risk. Now with the missile age, you can launch warheads at no risk. Your pilots, the numbers that were required to destroy entire cities were much smaller. Right, so you could ratchet up the cost really quickly without incurring much cost yourself, in the way that strategic bombing and firebombing required of states prior to the advent of the system. And one shouldn't underestimate the psychological impact of an adversary being able to destroy entire cities from afar at very little risk to itself. Right? So nuclear weapons ratchet up the ease of imposing punishment in ways that didn't exist prior to the nuclear period. So nuclear weapons fundamentally changed the kind of state. Is everyone familiar with basic uranium, plutonium, nuclear weapons, right? So I don't need to go through enriched uranium, plutonium, those are basic fission weapons. They have boosted fission weapons. So what is important, I think, is most regional powers are operating. So India, Pakistan, South Africa when it had nuclear weapons. South Africa, a little known fact, South Africa had nuclear weapons in 1979 to about 1991. Most states start with nuclear weapons, move to nuclear weapons. The advanced nuclear powers and nuclear weapons, most of the United States nuclear inventory is composed of thermonuclear weapons. Think of the A-bomb, that's fission and food to fission weapons.